Imagine a world where you can sail right up to the North Pole, where the largest ice sheet in the Northern Hemisphere is simply melting away.
The melt is winning this game.
We've now broken all-time records for 3 consecutive years.
As oceans continue to rise, flooding the streets of American cities half a world away.
What happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic.
Imagine a world where hurricanes and heat waves wreak havoc.
Breaking news as Hurricane Irma continues to show no mercy.
Just a hellstorm, the fire just whipped.
Where politicians deny the problem as temperatures continue to rise.
It's a hoax. I mean, it's a money-making industry, okay?
Greenland is an epicenter for climate change.
What if I told you this is already happening, right here, right now, that we are the primary cause and that only we have the power to stop it? This is Greenland. Though you will find very little greenery here, home to some of the most stunning wildlife on the planet, the world's largest island is more than 80% made up of pure ice.
It's only from the air that you really get a sense of the scale and the enormity of this ice sheet. And what's just staggering to imagine is that in the center of the island, this ice is 2 miles thick.
It looks as though time has stood still for thousands of years. But this environment reflects the big changes in our world's atmosphere. As the planet gets warmer, the Arctic is heating up at double the rate, and Greenland in particular is warming even faster. Jason Box is an American climate scientist who has been coming to this remote corner of the world for more than 20 years.
The amount of water that's produced all across this landscape has increased, like doubled in the last 50 years.
Doubled in the last 50 years.
Everywhere you go in Greenland, you can see and hear the ice sheet melting, sometimes a drip, sometimes a roar. Its surface is etched with fast-flowing rivers that carry the meltwater deep down to the bed.
This water cascades down thousands of feet and eventually makes its way to the bed. And it's heating the bed of the ice sheet. Everything's kind of stacking up that the ice is going faster than forecast.
And no sign of slowing down.
The melt is winning this game.
And the more Greenland melts, the more it speeds up the melting process. Take the large melt lakes that are forming on top of the ice sheet. Stunning to look at, but bad news for the ice. These lakes are deceptively beautiful because whereas the white of the ice actually reflects the sunlight, the piercing blue of the lakes actively absorbs it, heating them up and then accelerating the rate of melt. Perhaps the clearest example of this vicious melt cycle can be seen in Greenland's many glaciers. A glacier is a mass of thick ice that moves under the force of its own weight, like a slow river into the sea. But as meltwater moves through the ice, it softens it, draining to the bed where it then lubricates the movement of the glacier. We got a rare close-up view of one of Greenland's fastest moving glaciers. Named Helheim, after the Viking realm of the dead, it is vast and unforgiving.
This is one of the most productive glaciers in Greenland. It's about 3 Golden Gate Bridges wide, and it drains on the order of like 40 billion metric tons per year. It's like almost astronomical amount of water that this is delivering from high on the inland ice sheet down into the sea.
Between August of last year and August of this year, New York University scientists say Helheim retreated a whopping 2 miles, the furthest retreat inland they have seen in a decade. You can see vast chunks of it crashing into the water, a process called calving.
And what does that mean for the sea?
There's hundreds of glaciers like this in Greenland, and many of them have like doubled in speed. So the rate that Greenland is decanting into the ocean has really gone up in ways that surprise the science community.
And it's not only scientists who have been surprised. 56-year-old Tobias has been hunting with his dogs in Greenland his whole life, just like his father and grandfather before him. Only these days, there's far less ice for dog sledding.
Things is very fast. 15 years ago, all maybe from here to 500 meters and more is glacier. So we can start dog sledding from down from sea.
Is that something you have seen with your own eyes?
Yeah, I can see this. Now we cannot hunt in July month from dog sledding, only boat.
This year, Tobias has to take his dogs off the ice and back to town for the summer. He doesn't know if his grandsons will become hunters. But if the recent past is anything to go by, the future looks bleak. Warming in the last century has been faster than at any time in the past several million years.
How concerned are you by the scientific data that you've collected, by the changes that you've seen here?
What concerns me most is this concept of committed loss. So the amount of CO2 excess in the atmosphere due to humans burning fossil fuels mainly, that commits us to more than 1 meter of sea level rise.
That's roughly 3 feet. And this is where the rest of the world comes in. Greenland doesn't play by Las Vegas rules. What happens here doesn't stay here. As temperatures increase and the melt accelerates, Greenland has become the largest source of sea level rise globally. This year, after decades of decline, the amount of ice lost in Greenland was roughly equal to the amount gained. But Bach says this is an anomaly and that even drastic cuts in carbon dioxide emissions won't be enough to stop the continued melting.
Some have said that if Greenland is the canary in the coal mine, the canary is dead.
The canary is dead in that it indicates it's time to get out of the mine. In other words, we have a problem. And now's the time to start developing that response.
At Summit Station, weather patterns and climate change are the focus of much of the research. A remote American outpost funded by the National Science Foundation, it is perched at 10,600 feet on the very top of the Greenland ice sheet. The only way to get there is on a U.S. military plane, a 2-hour flight from the nearest airport of Kangerlussuaq. It lands on a runway of snow using giant skis. All equipment and personnel have to be flown in at great expense.
It doesn't get much more remote than this. And with the high altitude, the science that is being done here at Summit Station requires enormous resources and sheer physical effort. But this place is uniquely positioned to answer a crucial question. Has the Arctic reached a tipping point?
Engineer Zoe Corville explains that its isolation is in fact its greatest asset.
It's a very pristine site, and it's free from local influences of pollution.
Do you think Summit is important to the study of climate change specifically?
We've been making measurements since 1980 here, but we've also drilled to bedrock. So we have an ice core that extends back 140,000 years.
And so 140,000
years? Yes, 140. So we're actually standing on 2 miles worth of ice below us. And we can use the ice cores like you would use tree rings to get an idea of what past conditions of climate were like. And we can use what happened in the past to try to predict what's going to happen in the future.
But Summit's hefty price tag has made it a possible target for proposed budget cuts. The Trump administration wants to slash funding to the National Science Foundation. And many fear that Summit could be the first casualty.
I think it's the politics of short-term gain, long-term environmental pain.
Bach says he is frustrated by the White House's lack of commitment to climate change studies and its decision to withdraw from the Paris Accord.
Some people will say listen, look back over the history of the planet. There have been ice ages. There have then been huge heat waves. There's a natural extreme fluctuation in temperatures, and that's just part of living on planet Earth. What do you say to that?
It's true that there are natural cycles in climate, but what's happening now is human activity has become the dominant agent of change for about the last 150 years. The climate change we observe today is at least 80% due to human activity. We are now a force of nature.
And not a force for good. Mankind's presence in Greenland has been dwarfed by the dramatic scenery and by the extraordinary living creatures we share this unique habitat with. But in recent history, the balance of power has shifted, and with it, the responsibility to do something. Clarissa Ward, CNN, Greenland.